Okay, here we go. This is John Gonder for the Chabot Las Positas Community College District. And this is a basic lecture on TCP IP, the protocol suite, and the OSI model. And this is the first part covering the OSI model, layers, and TCP IP in general terms. And we'll follow this up with some more, looking more deeply into TCP and how it operates and some of the other protocols. So what are we talking about here? Well, all interaction in computers and networks, especially between devices themselves, is via a protocol. All traffic on the network is some interaction between various parts of the network. It's really not that hard to understand. We just have to see where it comes from. And we can analogize that by things we don't necessarily think of very often, how we interact with other people when we meet on the street. Just there's very subtle things that go on, but we're aware of them and we understand the definitions. If you walk toward me and I look at you and I smile and say, "Hi, how you doing?" and you say, "Hi," but nothing else, and then you look straight forward and walk on, what does that tell me? Well, you're busy, you don't have time to talk. That's analogous to the process of a device saying, "Hi, I'm awake, I've got some information I want to send you," and the other device saying, "Yeah, I see you, but you know what, I'm busy, I can't accept that data transmission at this time." So there's sets of rules, protocols for all of the interactions between things. There are steps that these devices take from first becoming aware of themselves and each other, to defining a path for information to exchange, to ending that set of conversational steps. And there's customary things that can be done. So some of those things involve negotiation. One device knows how to do three or four different things. The other device knows how to do a different group of things. How do they figure out which language they're going to speak? There's an interaction and a negotiation, right? And maybe they come to the conclusion they have nothing in common and they cannot communicate. So nothing happened. And so that's a troubleshooting problem, isn't it? So how is that organized? Well, there's requests for comments that define what are the calls and responses that are to be made in a certain case between certain devices and certain processes. They're used at a certain time when I'm waking up or when I'm ready to send data or when I'm done sending data. And they're used in a particular way and the meanings are defined and limited. And in the case of receiving a particular call, I have a set of fixed responses that I can choose from. And so everything is clean and clear and unambiguous. So the bottom line is that there's rules that govern the interface between processes or devices in their interaction between layers of the OSI model that we're going to look at. One important reason for doing this is then that the software or the hardware that implements the job of a particular layer can evolve. So long as that device or that process follows the expected rules of behavior in interacting with other people doing different jobs, the layers above and below them. So that this whole process of a message being encoded and transmitted across a channel, received and decoded, and then understood at the reception station can happen. Well, historically this evolved. Just like computers evolved and networks evolved. I mean, stuff was pretty funny back then. And if you remember back then, there was a lot of different kinds of equipment and it didn't necessarily work together. Everybody created their own method for getting those jobs done. Well, what are those jobs? Inside a computer, well, you've got a keyboard and software program, which is an interface to the user. And then there's an application inside that makes use of the operating system, just like you might make use of the concierge in a hotel, who has access to all of the features at that hotel that the resident, the application, doesn't even necessarily know about. But in creating information with a keyboard or a mouse, or inputting information in another way from a CD or copying something, there's processes that are common to all of these applications. That's organizing the information. And then if we want to transmit it, we need to have a session created with the other side so they're aware of us. And then we need to organize that information in some way, maybe break it down into page size chunks so we can transmit that across. And then we need to have a way of knowing whether the other person got the stuff in the mail right. And then error checking. And then we have to have some physical way of getting it across there. And as companies evolved in creating all their own stuff, it was very confusing. If you remember the process of trying to just get a printer to work on a computer, it could be very confusing, because even though there might be communication standards like RS-232, we used to call that the non-standard, because everybody would implement that in a different way, and you would be struggling to try to set the settings on devices, both the computer and the peripheral device, so that they would agree on how they were going to work. Remember RFCs, rules, protocols, agreements? Well, there evolved standards for defining, well, what are the jobs? And if I'm doing this job, what's a good way for me to interact with the guy doing the next job? And let's codify that. So let's create some rules. And so I can evolve a new piece of hardware or software to accomplish this job, so long as I follow the rules we set out for working with the other guy that that's next to me, I need to hand that information to. Well, the first model was sometimes called the Department of Defense model, and then that evolved into a model called the TCP/IP model. And that defined a layer called application layer, and then a transport layer, an internet layer, and then a network interface. So I've got my application, I'm generating information, I'm organizing it to go across, and then I got some way of controlling addressing across the internet, and then I've got some kind of physical transmission medium here. This evolved into the OSI model, which is 7 layers, and was a little bit more complete because it defined 3 different jobs that used to be wrapped up in the application layer of the older model. An application layer, a presentation layer, a session layer. And then there's the transport, network, data link, and physical layers. And then, of course, RFCs, protocols govern the interaction between these layers, so that if I have a new application, I can easily run this and I can easily work with everything else that was here without a problem if I obey the rules of interacting with the presentation layer, and then so on and so on. And we're going to examine these in a little bit more detail. And that's an important aspect of those. We can have continued development of each of those OSI layers. They can continue to grow and evolve. And then there is an organized method of creating and evolving these sets of rules. And then there is an organized way of evolving requests for comment, where we propose something and then people react to it, and then we create a draft of a standard and we look at it, and it eventually becomes an internet standard. So that's the OSI model. It's a 7-layer burrito. We can look at it and remember the layers by a couple of mnemonics. One of them is, please do not throw stale pizza away. Actually, that's up from the physical layer. Physical, data link, network, transport, session, presentation, and application. Okay, now let's take a quick look at, now this is sort of a look back. This is a picture from a PDF that I'm going to pull up in a second here. There was an ISO protocol suite, a suite of protocols that defined how to do these jobs. Apple created a complete suite of protocols defining how to do all the jobs from the application down to getting information out on a network and then up again to an application at the other end. DECnet, Novell thought they were going to rule the world with IPX and SPX. So this is a picture that shows sort of a trip through time here and then the evolution of the TCP/IP model. A suite of protocols that with various RFCs governing the rules of operation at that layer provides a more modern and these days pretty universal set of protocols for accomplishing and interfacing with all of these seven layers of jobs: application, presentation, session, transport, network, logical link or data link, and physical layer. See, back in the day, companies like IBM, as an example, wrote their own entire architecture, and then of course one of the reasons they did that was so you had to buy IBM stuff. And of course that wasn't really very good for the evolution of technology, which is why it's really good that we have the TCP/IP suite now, because anybody can build a box to do one of these jobs or write some code to do one of these jobs or write firmware for a device to do one of these jobs, so long as they follow the rules of interacting with the other layers. So long as a device follows the rules of operation at the various layers, then we can have good operation, we can have a peaceful network. Of course, one of the reasons we have work to do is everything doesn't always go as planned, does it? Well, again, I said there's mnemonics. All people sometimes need data processing. Application, presentation, session, transport, network, data link, physical. Or you could look at it as please don't throw stale pizza away. Oh, actually, it should be do not in for the network. So the protocols govern the interfaces between these layers, and the RFCs define the protocols. Okay, well, let's look at that again as an analogy. Okay, so Steve, a CEO, wants to do lunch with Bill, another CEO. So that's the application, generates a little information. The secretary organizes that. The assistant then puts that into a form for transmission. Mail guy at layer 4 is going to decide how we're going to ship this. The shipping department, right, is going to deal with an address. FedEx is going to deal with the process of getting it physically on some transmission medium and across to the other side. And here's something we'll look at again in a minute. We may have more than one different kind of physical medium when we're getting across from one end of a network to the next. I could have a cable here that connects me to my printer. That's really great. But then how am I connecting to Comcast? How are they connecting to Sprint? How are they connecting to the local area network at the other end? And so various physical media require different ways of access to the media, which is a job at layer 2. At the other end, then, that box that's been transmitted is unpacked. And at each layer, it's opened up, and information inside says who you're going to give it to at the next layer up. And eventually, it gets to the destination, the message is received, right? And that's what we're looking at in the operation of the app of the seven-layer burrito here. I've got one end of a network. I create information, it's presented and organized, it's transported, and at each layer, that information itself is then encapsulated. We'll talk more about that. It's split into chunks that are the right size for being transmitted, and then there's information added to that as a header that says who did this, which application generated this data, right? And down at the bottom, then, We're getting this ready to go on FedEx, so it's going to go in a FedEx box. It's going to have a FedEx header, a trailer, typically including some error correction, and then it's transmitted across a physical medium to the other end. So at each end, from the top down, we're creating data, we're putting into segments, we're adding headers to it. It becomes a packet. So this is what we're calling these protocol data units. At each layer of the protocol, we might call their product that they hand down to the next layer. Here it's data. Then it becomes a segment. Then that's assembled into a packet. And then, depending on the medium, we put it in the right kind of box for that particular transport, right? One kind of box for a plane, one kind of box for a truck, one kind of box for a truck. So we've got layer two, which we'll talk about in a minute, then has different ways of addressing that physical layer depending upon whether it's wireless, cable, frame relay, whether it's, you know, whatever. So at each layer, there becomes a header that defines, when we're unpacking that, who we're going to hand it up to. So at this receiving end here, layer 2 strips off that layer 2 header and says, oh, okay, who at layer 3 do I hand this to? Layer 3 strips off the layer 3 header and says, oh, okay, here's the layer 4 header. Who do I hand this to? Layer 5, 6, and 7. Now again, remember, we talk about this in a second, layers 5 and 6 and 7 are all at the application level, and an application may or may not need all of those particular services. So when we look more closely at the suite, depending upon what application we're talking about, there may not be a layer 6 or 5 aspect to that application. It may not need that particular service. So then, to walk down the model from layer 7. Layer 7, the application, I love that. Isn't that a great tattoo? There's protocols. We're going to define the process we use. What kind of messages are we using? What are the syntax? What sort of requests are we able to deal with? Are we willing to deal with? What's our response to say, oh, I can do that. Oh, I've got a problem with that. How the message is sent, and what's our expected response. And then, of course, like I've been talking about, defining our interaction with the next layer. So application is where the user or the application creates some data that then is handed on down. So a software process at the application layer can be an application, can be a service, can be a system operation. There's a number of different things. Let's take a quick look a little bit more closely at this PDF. This particular poster has been around really for quite a while. Net3 I don't think even exists anymore. And this is a very dense picture really that can be printed out into a wall size poster. You can get this yourself in our student resources area and print it out. Have that there in your bedroom. But if let's take a closer look at it. So, layers of the OSI model, colored in, and then even down here in the corner is a list of all of the various protocols, AppleTalk Address Resolution Protocol, on down to Zone Information Protocol, that are contained in these various, here's NetBUI. So, like I said, over time, ISO created a TCP suite. AppleTalk created a protocol suite. AppleTalk created a protocol suite. DECnet had their own protocol suite. Novell had their own protocol suite. And they all ended up going by the wayside in general, although certainly like NetBUI, there are certainly remnants of these protocols still out there, and there are specialized protocol suites for particular applications, industrial or secure operation or whatever. The predominant suite for everything out there today is the TCP/IP suite. And let's take a little look here. So at the application layer with this color, we can see Network Time Protocol, NTP. Over here, File Transfer Protocol, FTP. And here's the RFC that contains the rules of operation. And so when we're analyzing a particular protocol, looking to see if it's working properly or troubleshooting it, the first thing for us to do is realize that we need to understand what are the rules that are supposed to be being followed before we can see whether or not they are followed or whether or not something went wrong. So we can study and learn from that RFC. HTTP, Hypertext Transport Protocol, BOOTP, which is Domain Name Services, Dynamic Host Control Protocol, DHCP, which is another more recent version of Dynamic Host Control Protocol, Simple Mail Transport Protocol, Telnet, X Windows. Notice that NTP, what's the next color here? The next color here is Layer 4 Transport. So for NTP, there's actually no presentation or session services required. So NTP does not make use of any Layer 6 or Layer 5 protocols. Well, what color is DHCP? It's session layer. It means that there's actually no high-level application or presentation services being used. DHCP, there's no really user interaction there. It's actually between devices. And when later on we look more closely at the operation of these protocols, we'll see that. DHCP works then directly with transport layer at layer 4. Telnet. Now, remember, layer 4 transport, we're going to talk about more in a minute. There's two aspects of it, TCP and UDP, two main aspects of it. TCP and UDP, Transport Control Protocol, and User Datagram Protocol. So we'll see here in this TCP/IP suite, some applications make use of UDP, which we'll talk more about, is simpler. Some applications make use of TCP, which is more complex and provides more features. Here is Domain Name Services and NetBIOS and these others, which sometimes make use of TCP, sometimes make use of UDP at the transport layer. Well, then, they all have a network layer. Here's the next color, network layer setup. They make use of Internet Protocol, governed by RFC 0791. Notice that some of these protocols really don't have any upper layer aspects to them, like these routing protocols, BGP, EGP, OSPF, and RIP, IGRP. Other ones, Internet Control Message Protocol, RFC 0792, again, doesn't have any upper layer aspects to it. It's only network layer and on down. Well then, in order to get onto a physical medium, all of these protocols need to make use of a layer 2 protocol. Notice there's a whole bunch of different types of layer 2 protocols, and the reason is because you need a different way of accessing a fiber optic link than you do to access a wireless radio device, or accessing an Ethernet cable, or accessing another physical medium. So there's different logical link controls or data link layer aspects depending upon which physical layer we're using. And then, of course, depending upon which physical layer you're using, there's a different specification for how we're going to do that. What will the signaling method be? Is it radio wave? Is it a laser pulse? Is it a 1 or 0 defined by a voltage level on a cable. And how do we do that? You know, so at each layer there's RFCs, there's specifications for the operation and the interaction at the other layer. Well, the next two down from application, like I said before, may or may not be present depending upon the application, presentation, and session, where that information is presented in some way according to a format and then is segmented into chunks getting ready for packaging. So at the presentation layer, that might be about formatting it. There's various types of formats that we could use to present that data. And this could be done all within the application itself and doesn't require a completely separate protocol for that, you know, maybe or maybe not. So looking at that this way from the user, depending upon the application, we're going to have some kind of segmentation of that information that's handed on down. On the way back, information coming to us from the transport layer then, remember there's a header, the application layer, and part of that header says, well, who generated this? Was it the email application, or was it the web browser, or something else? So, session layer, if we have services that we need, like logging into a server at the other end, or managing, for instance, the timeout. How long will we wait if we don't hear from somebody on the other side? Or maybe we've logged in, but if there's nothing happening, how long do we wait before we say, well, we're not connected to that session anymore? And then managing the segmentation of that data into useful chunks. Again, at the session layer, we get stuff, we chunk it up, we hand it down to the network layer. From the network layer, then we get that. One of the things we might do is make sure everything's being received in the right order. And then we're reassembling that for handing back up to an application layer. Some of the things we might agree, like I was saying, how long will we wait if there's no activity before we terminate a data transfer session? How long will these segments be? How big will the chunks of information that we put on this page? Is this 8.5 by 11 page, or is it a legal size page, 11 inches long? Well, the next layer down, our transport layer, is where we're going to manage the process of getting that data across to the other end. Well, how is that different from managing the process across the net? Well, we've got an internet, and we're going to talk about this in a second, where we've got to have some addressing. We've got to have that in a package, and it's got to have an address to go to the other end. But then there's the process of managing that delivery. Did the other guy get it? Do I need to send it again? If I sent 10 packages, did he get them all? Was he missing package number 3? So managing that delivery process is different from managing the process of physically transmitting it, getting it on the truck and off the truck. So our transport layer includes aspects of it like the three-way handshake that you've looked at already, where I want to synchronize with you. The other end says, oh, that's cool. And I say, okay, so now we have a session going, and we can let the upper layer know we can start transmitting some data via this session. There's two main ways our transport layer in our TCP/IP suite to transmit that data, to manage that transmission of data. One is UDP, User Datagram Protocol, which is very simple. It's like a postcard. You put it out there, maybe the guy got it, maybe the guy didn't. We don't know. It does allow for source and destination ports. In other words, we'll get to that in a second, source and destination ports. But TCP is more like registered mail. I sent these things out and I'll get an acknowledgement. And if the guy didn't get it, if it was damaged in transit, then I know that and I can resend that, which is a very important thing. But it does take up resources, and it does take up time. So if I've got a bunch of different processes going on my computer, email, HTTP, etc. Some of them may use TCP, some of them may use UDP. There's also going to be a port number attached, that's part of the header, that says, here's the process that generated this information, because we may have more than one thing going on at a time, right? I'm looking at a web page. My email client in the background is also checking for email, getting mail, sending mail. I might have three different web pages open. Each of those is a different process, because this web page is connected to LL Bean, this web page is connected to eBay, this web page is connected to cat videos. Each of those has a different port number attached at this end, and then in terms of the final address, has a different port number attached as well to know what process to go to that end, so I don't send my LL Bean order to the cat video server. Right? And some of the lower level applications that don't need all of those things, they go directly to IP, right? ICMP, OSPF that we looked at. We have well-known port numbers, which are defined and regulated, and they're the most common port number used for a particular application. So if I am sending and receiving data via file transfer protocol, I'm using ports 20 and 21 when I'm talking to that server. I'm using port 80 when I'm talking to a web server, etc. I'm using port 443 when I'm using secure HTTP communications. So, to look a teeny bit more closely at our transport layer methods, UDP, like a postcard, simple, connectionless. I send it out there. Hopefully it gets there. We don't know if the guy's even on the line. We don't know if he got it. We don't know if he can read it. We don't care. The receiver doesn't know when it's coming. So we still have our stream of data divided up into segments, and we send those out. They could end up taking different routes across the internet, and so they might be received out of order. We don't care if one of them got lost. We don't care. That's UDP. Quick, but not reliable. There's no synchronous connection made between me and you before I send you a UDP packet. I just put your address on it, send it out to you. Good luck with that. Well, why might we use this sort of undependable protocol? Well, TCP, as we're going to see in a second, requires a lot more interaction, which means a lot more time. And it has the opportunity, because of that interaction, to resend lost data. But so, for instance, if I'm sending you a video, 30 frames a second, if you miss one of those frames, you might not even see it. And you don't care, and I don't care, and there's no time for me to resend that frame. By the time you tell me you didn't get frame number 18, and I resend that, you're on to a different frame in that video, and that information is useless to you. Same thing with a voice over IP conversation. If a bit of information is missing, you might still understand the conversation, and if I resend you the bit, it's useless to you because the time for using that is gone. So UDP is a good way of doing things like that, where time dependent, if it's lost, it's useless, so there's no reason to try to understand it was lost and retransmit it. So it's a good protocol. TCP as a transport layer method, connection oriented, reliable, more features. SYN, SYNAC, and ACK. Oh, we've established a connection. I know you're there. You know I'm here. Now you're ready, and I'm ready to send and receive information. And if there's a minute when we're not sending information, but I still want to keep that communication channel open, I can send you keep alives to say, yeah, I don't have anything to send you right now, but I want to maintain this channel open. You know, we're on the phone. We're not saying anything right now. But I'm not going to hang up. And you know I don't want to hang up, so you don't hang up. So there's a graceful start, we say, to the connection establishment. It's graceful both for the establishment and termination. I send a sin from A to B. B receives that and acknowledges that that sin was received, and then along with that has two flags set in that packet. Yeah, I acknowledge your sin, and I send you a sin too, so I am ready and able to connect. So I'm ready and able to connect with B. B says, okay, I received your request to connect. Not only that, I'm ready and able to connect to you. And so then A acknowledges receipt of that sin, and now we have a session open. And when we're done, A sends a fin that says, well, I'm done sending and I'm ready to hang up. What about you? And if B is ready to hang up too, he sends first, yeah, I received your request to hang up. And furthermore, I'm going to send you a fin because I don't have any more data to send you, so I'm willing to hang up at this time as well. Okay, and then A acknowledges, yes, I received your fin request. So we both send a fin request. We both acknowledge receipt of that. Now we're ready to drop this connection. But it happens gracefully. If A wanted to hang up but B still had stuff to say, then he could do that without A just banging the phone down. Right? So it's graceful start, graceful end using TCP. But of course, as you can see, there's a lot more to this. And obviously it takes some time, even in milliseconds, which is why UDP is a very useful protocol when time is of the essence. And if something needs to be retransmitted, don't bother because you can't use it at that end anyway. And then, of course, a big feature of TCP is the ability to retransmit information. So that's why there's acknowledgments for these packets. So when the sender sends packet 1, packet 2, packet 3, and the receiver acknowledges packet 2, he's saying, well, I received packet 2, and then packet 4, and then there's a connection lost, and then sends packet 6, then this guy can acknowledge a particular packet. I've received everything up through 4, and I'm expecting packet 5. Sender can resend packet 5. And now here's an acknowledgement that says I'm expecting packet 7 yet. So in other words, I've received everything up through 6. So there's a back and forth that goes on there, sending, so we can have packets in flight, acknowledgements come. Depending on what the acknowledgement says, well, we'll know whether somebody received a particular packet and whether or not we need to resend that. What's the next job that needs to get done? For layer 3 and layer 2, we need a logical address, like a street address, where we can send this and manage that. But then we're also going to need some kind of physical address of somebody at a particular workstation, whether it's a cubicle number or a something that defines the actual destination within that logical street address at the other end. So we've got IP addressing, and then we've got media access control addressing. Logical addressing is where, physical addressing is who, and the network layer is going to take care of that logical addressing. And in our TCP/IP suite, the protocol for that is Internet Protocol. So we get our stuff from the network, from the transport layer, and then we're going to add a network layer header to that, including the source street address and the destination street address, and then we're going to hand that down to the data link layer. So logical addressing, we're using Internet Protocol version 4 or version 6, and so we can define where here with a country and a zip code and a street address we can get on down to the local area network where that device lives. So we've got a source, network address, and a device address, a destination network address, and then a device address from the data link layer. And that's how things are able then to get across the net from one IP address to another IP address across a set of connections. So application layer, transport layer, network layer, data link layer. At each layer, it's encapsulated. Well, now what about the physical address? Media access control address. At this data link layer, depending upon what physical kind of medium we're using, the data link layer is going to create a frame, a final encapsulation of everything from all the layers up above, with a definition of what's the physical address that I'm sending this from, what's a physical address of the next hop it's going to. And then typically a header sometimes includes, say, start bits saying, hey, you know, like a headlight, there's a train coming down the track, look out for this packet. And then a frame trailer, maybe with a cyclic redundancy check, an algorithm that says, well, here's a number that was created by an algorithm based on the bits that were in here. And when you recalculate this at the other end, you should get this same number, which tells you none of those bits got mashed as a part of this process. And then taillights on this packet that says, oh, well, that's the end of the packet. So we had the beginning of the packet, here's everything inside, here's redundancy check, and then here's the taillights, here's the end of the packet. And depending upon the physical layer, that those headlights and taillights are a little bit different. Particular set of ones and zeros send in a particular way. Well, remember when I said at the physical layer then, FedEx, you know, might be in a plane, might be in a truck, you know, it might be on a railroad car, and there's different ways of dealing with each of those physical layers, but we never open that package and look inside. Everything's data above that. So what we're going to be dealing with devices that are in the middle between the source and destination devices is at each side, there's got to be somebody at a FedEx distribution center here that takes this off a truck and rewrites the barcode on it before putting it on the plane. And then when it comes off the plane at the next distribution center, the barcode gets rewritten to go onto a railroad car, etc., etc., until finally we get to the end. And of course, the street address of the source and the street address of the destination all remained the same. But in the meantime, there was this at layer one and layer two, this flow of information that says, okay, it came from this guy over here at this distribution center. It's going by truck to the next distribution center. All right, now it's rewritten. It's coming from this distribution center via plane to the next distribution center. Okay, it's coming off the plane. Now it's going on to a railroad car to the next distribution center. And that's the process of going through bridges and switches and routers to get to that final destination. So within a router, we have the additional look at that IP address. We're not rewriting the IP address, but we're looking to see, gee, I've got a bunch of different trucks going out here. Which distribution center should be the one that I send it to next to get most efficiently to that final destination? So that's the process of routing. We're still rewriting the MAC layer here, saying, well, it's coming from this interface and it's going to that interface on the other guy. As a part of the routing process in a router, we also determine which of our interfaces we're going to use, which truck we're going to stick this thing on to get to the next hop on its way to the final destination. So that's a hop-by-hop forwarding across intermediate systems, switches or bridges or routers or whatever, between here. And of course, there can be more than one way to get across this cloud of routers in the middle of the internet. So that's why some packets may come in different order, because they ended up being routed differently. Oh, that truck's full. I need to send it over here on this truck. It's going to end up getting to the same place, but it's going to have one more hop or one less hop. So depending upon how long or how big or how complex our network might be, and what devices are in between the address of the source and the address of the destination, we're going to have different devices, maybe across two physical modems. Here's through one router, a local area network, to another router, then some kind of physical situation, maybe some kind of repeater. It's a hub or it's a switch. Finally gets to the destination. The data link protocol type may very well change as it goes across the network. From the network layer on up, it remains the same because it's this logical address this came from, it's this logical address where it's going. So like I said before, we've got a logical address from the network layer. We come down to the data link layer, and the data link layer is going to frame that. It's going to pack it up in the right kind of packaging to fit on that particular type of truck or type of plane that we're using at the physical layer. So we're going to pack it up. User data, a TCP segment, an IP packet, an Ethernet frame. If we're using Ethernet, I've got a wire going over here to the router. So it's going to be packed up and it's going to be sent with a particular kind of framing. It's going to have a headlight and a taillight. Particular pattern of bits that says, oh, there's a packet coming right behind me. And then a particular pattern of bits that say, well, that's the end of the packet. So that the devices can define where the packet begins and ends, because it might have more or less data in it, right? It might be a different length. And then can hand it up to the next layer after removing their layer's encapsulation. So your data link layer typically is two parts. There can be part of it implemented in the software, the operating system. Part of it can be implemented in hardware and firmware, like a network interface card. Here's a network interface card that has what? It's an RJ45 connector for an Ethernet cable. And when we're sending a packet across from here to the router, I have to have a source physical address and a destination physical address. There has to be something absolutely unique about this physical source of this packet, and so that's our media access control address. And like I said before, for each physical medium, there's going to be a different way of defining, you know, what's the source interface here, what's the destination interface here, what's the source interface, destination interface. And so for each type of physical medium, there's going to be different rules about how to access and share the medium. And that's the job of the data link layer, the lower half of the data link layer, to implement that process of independently of the other protocols. They don't know what's going on. We're actually managing getting those pulses of light off of the fiber, or getting those pulses of electricity off the cable properly, and then interpreting them as ones and zeros, and then sending out the ones and zeros with the proper electrical signaling method that's appropriate to this physical media we're using. And then there's rules and protocols for each of the physical media. You know, what is the method of encoding used? What is the signal? What constitutes the right time between signals, the right time to wait to see whether or not the voltage is going to go up to 3 or down to 0, so that we can have the appropriate ones and zeros sent in a way that can be interpreted properly at the other end. So our protocols, our standards, what's the signal like, what kind of connectors are going to use, how should the cables be made, what should they look like. That's all the things that go on at the physical layer for each different type of physical signaling method that we might use. So, what constitutes a 1? What constitutes a 0? What does it look like? Those are the rules that we follow according to the protocols. And again, same thing at each and every layer. Okay, so there we go. Let's go back and review just a little bit. So there's a lot of processes that are common to each end of our node in the process of creating organizing, sending, receiving, and interpreting information across a net. By having a OSI model that defines those jobs, we can define the rules for interfacing between each of those jobs, and then we can evolve those jobs independently so long as the guy or the guys around us know how we're going to operate and we operate in the right way. We can do our job any way we want so long as we talk nice to the people on either side of us. So again, the analogy is we're creating a request here, and then we're writing it down and we're organizing that, and then we're making sure that it gets to the other side, putting in a package, giving it to somebody who's going to run it across a plane, truck, some way to the other side. Then that box is then unpacked and eventually gets to the person or the process for whom it's intended. So that's the process of transforming our network, our human data that we create, and ways of organizing it, and then ways of talking about it. You're going to hear these words. The protocol data unit at the session layer is the data. It makes it into a segment for the transport layer. We create a packet at the network layer. It's called a frame at the data link layer, and it's all bits, ones and zeros, as it goes across some physical medium. So, depending upon what the application is that we're operating, it may or may not need all the services of all the layers of the OSI model, and it may use one or another type of transport method depending upon the services that it needs. Does it need to get there quick and doesn't really care about retransmission, connectionless, UDP? Or do we want to be able to retransmit lost packets, for example, and use TCP? And there's an RFC that governs the rules of the road, the rules of operation, the syntax, the way they're supposed to talk to each other at each of these layers. So finally, just a few references. Of course, for training, acm.org, your $19 student membership gets you hundreds of books and certification training classes. Lure Chapel, great source of information. Wireshark, obviously the source of information for our primary data analysis application. Good article on TCP/IP. Of course, the original canonical information that we look directly to at places like IANA.org. A great source for PDFs that are really well written is at Cisco.com. For instance, just go to Cisco.com and search for what you're looking for. So if you're looking for more information about a protocol, you're trying to learn more about BGP or RIP or something, or just the whole of TCP/IP, there are great PDFs at Cisco.com. Then, of course, some credits for some the pictures that came from here. And then, of course, yeah, there it is at Wikipedia. And there's some great pictures and presentations of the OSI model itself. And there you go. That's basic TCP/IP, the OSI model, the layers, how they work, how they're organized. In the next section, we'll dissect especially the transport layer a little bit more thoroughly and start to look at some of the common things that your network does.